you. Well, let's get started. Good morning, everyone. It's been so nice to be at this festival. I'm Wendy Freeland. I'm honored to give this talk about my teacher, my beloved teacher, John Kenneth Adams. Some of you may have heard some of his playing as you entered. He was playing Schubert's C major adagio. I also want to say it's just been wonderful to be at this festival and to talk about this shared lineage we have. It's been very edifying as a pianist and as a teacher. So, John Adams. I've got some wonderful pictures of him. I met him in 1996. I was in search of a grad school, and everyone said, pick your grad school based on the teacher. Well, I actually chose University of South Carolina, chose to audition there because it was close to family living in Augusta, Georgia. My mother said, they've just built a new music building, go check it out. So I drove up for an audition on a January morning and sat and played for three of the piano faculty. I played Beethoven's Opus 22, and I know there was no hiding behind my messy, uneven 16th notes. And John Adams was there. He was sitting kind of like this. And I could not read him. I knew I had technical problems and really wanted someone to help me. Fortunately, a few weeks after, I got a letter of acceptance. And in the fall, I landed there in Columbia, South Carolina. And even though I did not pick the school based on the teacher, something felt right. Maybe you've gone to a place before and you know I'm meant to be here. Well, I visited the head of the department. I said, with whom should I study? He said, you need to talk with John Adams. He's really good with students that have technical problems. So I went and I knocked on his door. He opened it. I said, Dr. Adams? He said, Professor, dear. And even though I would come to learn that all the students called him Mr. Adams, in my mind, the word professor stuck. And he came to embody all the good in that term for me. Let me look at my notes. Don't you love technology? Una momento, I'm sorry. Okay. So John was at this time 66, and let me tell you a little bit about John. He was born in Fort Smith, Arkansas, to Vera and Arthur. This was December 11, 1934. He had two sisters, and his mother was a working woman. He told me that he and his sisters would make the family dinner. Later, the family moved to Birmingham, Alabama, and his father was employed in some capacity with the state, whereby he worked with the inmates in line that were going to receive the death penalty, and John would go to work with his dad, and he said he would hop up in the electric chair and play. Born with great aptitude, talent, and a natural ear, he began serious study of the piano at age 11 at the Birmingham College of Music's preparatory program. Now, in 1949, at the age of 15, his family moved to Kansas City, Missouri. Here he began working with a very fine teacher, Mary Newitt Dawson. There she is. She would be the first student in the Matthay lineage, the first of four teachers with whom John would work that had a Matthay lineage. Miss Dawson was a student of Mr. Mannheimer. Mary also had a lineage with Debussy, as she had studied with Maurice Dumesnil, a student of Debussy. And maybe this is where John first started really being considerate of the French sound, the French touch, and started his love of the French piano literature. Now, he worked with other teachers throughout his life, not of Matthay lineage. He worked with John Wills. He worked with Joanna Rawdon. He worked with Alonka Deckers. He also worked with Carl Friedberg. You'll remember that he came to the States as the accompanist for Fritz Kreisler, and he ended up in New York, and he was head of the department at Juilliard. Now, when John was 17, the Kansas City Music Club sent him to this new exciting festival in Aspen. It had been going on for a few years, the Aspen Music Festival, and that's where he worked with Joanna Grawdon. And he said they worked like dogs. She was an amazing woman. She and her husband ended up fleeing Germany during the time of the Nazi regime. They ended up in California. She had studied with Arthur Schnabel. And John asked her, "How did you luck out to get to study with Arthur Schnabel?" And she said, "Well, John, I just picked up the phone." John loved these kinds of little stories. Aha! Now, let's go back. You all know who that is. But let me tell you a little more. So he did go to UMKC. He got his Bachelor of Arts degree with Mary Dawson. And then he entered the Yale School of Music as a Victor Wilson scholar, studying with his next teacher with the Matthay lineage, Bruce Simons. John said of Bruce, Mr. Simons, "He gave me a pattern to follow in my own career, knowing full well one has to teach and perform to a high standard, as well as be ready for a lot of public service. He made me feel that was a high goal in life, and I am forever grateful to him." Now, after he finished his master's degree at Yale, he was named a Fulbright Scholar. And I've learned a lot of our Matthay members have had that honor. He went to London and studied at the Royal Academy of Music under Hilda Dederich, his third teacher of Matthay principles. John took some notes from his studies with her, and I have... Let me tell you some of the concepts that he gained that I would hear in my lessons. Think inside the key. Aim for the tone spot in playing. Pre-hear the type of sound you want to make. Never continue pressing upon the key once the sound has been made. If you play evenly, you don't have to play so fast. Think of the thumb as operating from as far back as possible. So this was a life-changing time for him. He loved London. He had some wonderful performance opportunities. And in his years post-retirement, he became a member of the Royal Overseas Club, which is a club that supports arts and culture education. And he would talk about London. I know he listened to the London proms every summer. And as I say, post-retirement, he made 22 trips to Europe, and almost all of them included a stop in London. He also followed the royals very carefully and was enchanted by Princess Diana. Now, after coming back from London, he got a post at the University of Texas, Austin, joining the piano faculty. This was 1961, and he started studying. There's another fine picture. And he started studying with Mr. Mannheimer. That's him down at the bottom frame. At the top, Mr. Mannheimer and someone, maybe please identify. Does anyone know who he's with there, Mr. Mannheimer? No? So anyway, John's smiling, happy and young, and I know these were great times. I don't know how many years he studied with Mr. Mannheimer. I know he participated in many Mannheimer festivals and reunions. And oftentimes in my lessons, he would say, "Mr. Mannheimer would say, Mr. Mannheimer this, Mr. Mannheimer." Now, in 1964, he began a career at the University of South Carolina. There's a festival program. This is from 1975. Very tasteful. He had a very tasteful way of living, and I'm going to talk about that shortly. But anyway, he started work at the University of South Carolina in 64. He played a lot with his colleagues. He loved to play with sopranos, cellist in residence, also the violinist John Bauer, loving solo performing, chamber music, and he loved opera. John was devoted to solo performing, and he loved the French piano music and was making a name for himself with this. He went to Carnegie Hall in 1978, performing a program of Debussy, Dundee, and Fauré. He also gave the program at Yale, and he gave lectures at Juilliard. He would later perform all of Debussy's works in cycle over a two-year period at the University of South Carolina and receive a grant to record all of Debussy's works. He also published a series of articles in Piano Quarterly on the works of Debussy. How about we listen to him playing some Debussy?
Thank you.
John was a busy man dedicated to teaching, scholarship, and performing. During the 70s and 80s, he also worked with the United States Information Service and gave over 150 concerts throughout Central and South America. He also performed at the Concertgebouw in Amsterdam and at Wigmore Hall. He toured Italy with Gioventù Musicale, performed in Spain, Turkey, and Scotland, and was a member of the French Piano Institute. In the United States, he performed at the National Gallery of Art, the Phillips Collection, and as you know, he gave many programs for the Matthay Festivals and Mannheimer Festivals. I have a record of one of his performances with the Matthay Festival at San Jose State in 1978. He performed pictures at an exhibition, Schumann's Papillons, and a set of Schubert waltzes and Chopin mazurkas. Something he really loved to do and that folks really loved to see and hear was give piano portraits. Piano portraits were these lovely presentations where he would sit at the piano, play, show slides of like art, gardens, furniture, architecture, porcelain, people, and he would talk. So it was a real overall cultural experience. He gave these piano portraits on several composers, including Stravinsky, Schumann, Debussy, Beethoven, Poulenc, Bach as well. He liked the old and the new. Some folks remember him playing Davidovsky's Synchronisms number 6. He performed that quite regularly. He also performed John Adams' China Gates. And he was the first to perform Chevsky's The People United Will Never Be Defeated in the state of South Carolina. He was very proud of that one-hour variation set. He gave a lot of himself. That's a nice picture of him performing out in Wyoming, where he had a sister living. He gave a lot to the state of South Carolina. He was very involved in the South Carolina Music Teachers Association. He had the position of president. He was named Teacher of the Year for South Carolina. And in later years would be given a Lifetime Achievement Award by South Carolina Music Teachers Association. So here he is with a group of piano teachers from South Carolina. He also participated in South Carolina Public Radio. He gave a series of lectures on opera, and he gave a series of lectures on Robert and Clara Schumann. At the University of South Carolina, he established a concerto aria competition, as well as a Friends of Music recital series. Well, back to the public radio, there he met Marion McPartland. Some of you might know of her, the jazz pianist. He had her to his house, and she played on his piano, which he was very proud of his piano. And then, he liked to tell this story, she stopped and said, she listened to it until the total point of decay and said, wow, what a bee. He became an MTNA fellow in 2016, and I'm with him there on the left, and Nancy Elton is there in the middle. This was at the conference in San Antonio, and we were able to buy two banquet tables for southern states. We had teachers from Georgia, South Carolina, and Alabama there, and John really liked that we were all sitting together, and it was a very special night. Let me tell you a little bit about him personally. Well, he had a lovely way of living. He had a beautiful home. It was about 30 miles outside of the city of Columbia. And I know he would like, he liked to finish his school day by grabbing a sandwich at a coffee shop or going to his favorite restaurant, Motor Supply, having a nice piece of fish and a drink and before driving home. I don't know when he practiced, if he liked to practice late at night or in the mornings. He did tell me after I bought my first piano that I would be surprised at the times I would go to the piano. He loved to sit by his fire. He had a fireplace, and in recent years he built a sun porch, and because he loved his garden, he loved to be out working in the yard. I remember visiting him and he said, "I just burnt my grass. It likes it." I had never heard of a lawn needing to be burned, but I learned that. Here's his garden. There's a nice maple tree right there. So I know he loved flowers, and he would regularly bring in camellias from his camellia bushes and float them in a bowl of water in the studio. One day on my way to school, I was just enchanted by all of this purple stuff growing all over. I thought they were lilacs. And I had experienced lilacs while living in Pennsylvania as a child. So I pulled over and grabbed a few stems to take in to him. And we have them here on this campus, you know. So he opened his door and I gave them to him. And he just went, "Hmm." Well, it was wild wisteria and had a bunch of ants on it. But I tried. Oh, and another funny thing I have to tell you. So in years post-retirement, when I was settled in Alabama, I would visit him two or three times before a recital to get lessons. So I went to use his restroom. And I looked right out the window, and there was the birdbath. So I then, you know, re-entered the piano room, and I said, "You know, your birdbath is right outside your bathroom window." And he said, "I know." So that was by design. And I also noted that on his bathroom sink, his fragrances were all lined up so neatly and dusted. And it made me think of Maurice Ravel, you know, who laid his comb, his brush, his mirror all perfectly on his dressing table. Of course, the special feature of John's home was his piano. I don't know how he secured this piano, but it's a 1975 CD I learned from Steve a few years ago. That's a Model D that was for concert use. It was one of the pianos housed in the basement of the Steinway Gallery in New York City for visiting artists to choose for their concert. Well, he loved this piano and he tweaked it over the years. He worked with a couple of different technicians to get it to sound just like he wanted it to sound and respond just as he wanted it to respond. He also always kept a little tuning hammer around to get his notes just right. I think he had his home built with this in his piano in mind. That window went the full, almost the full length of the wall. I was talking with someone recently, you know, I know it's not good for pianos to be in front of windows, but we just can't resist. What a wonderful opportunity to play and have a window. He would often have parties for his students. We would visit and play whatever we wanted, and he would cook for us. Also, he would let us come to his house to run a recital, you know, in advance of the real performance, and he would invite his neighbors. He lived in a community with about six or seven other houses, and I know they loved to come to his house. He would have food and wine, and he was the kind of guy that would always keep a party going. You know, you could always hear him talking or laughing. And you might remember this, those of you who knew him. And it wasn't that his laugh or his talk was loud. It's just that it was kind of sing-songy and it was a low hum. So he always kept a conversation going, and he had different kinds of laughs, and I was almost wanted to imitate them, but I couldn't do justice. But it was like he was throwing a laugh up in the air, and then he would kind of table it by saying, "Well," or it might be a just an outburst kind of laugh. He had a really good laugh one time when I visited him. I brought my friend, a Swedish soprano friend, and we ran a program for him. And then we sat down to have some Earl Grey tea and English cups and saucers. And she lifted her teacup, and the handle broke off. And he just, and she said, "John, I come all this way, really, and you give me a broken teacup?" And he just continued to laugh, and she laughed, and this went on for about 10 minutes. I think he was good with money. He liked to say the word business, and I would notice him looking at the paper and reading the financial section, and he would say, "I'm a good businessman." So one year I had the remains of my student loan. I was going to use it for my living expenses, and I lucked out and got a job at a hotel playing three times a week. So I realized that would cover my living expenses, and I decided to take this little kitty of money and do something with it. So I asked him if he could recommend a financial advisor, and he said, "Don't you have someone in your family you can ask?" I said, "No." So he relented and told me who he used. Right before his retirement, he made the largest gift, monetary gift, to the School of Music that had ever been made. So I guess he was a good businessman. John loved his home. He loved his teaching. He loved his garden. People. He loved to travel. Now, he started going to South Korea in 1986. He ended up making 9 trips from 1986 to the late 90s and met many fine Korean pianists. He performed there, he gave master classes there, and he brought many Koreans over to the University of South Carolina. And people like me really benefited from this. I made some wonderful friends, got to visit there myself. This was a wonderful pianist, Jeon Song. This is a picture of the Tuscan region. He did this. He was kind of playing around with pencil and watercolor at a certain phase of his life. University of South Carolina had an opera program, and I joined them as pianist one summer. It was in Cortona, Italy, and John went too. And that was really fun. I got to see him in a different light. He wore these colorful shirts, and he said, "You know, I normally can't dress like this, but I would like to dress like this all the time." At the University of South Carolina, he would have your normal trousers, a dress shirt, short sleeve dress shirt, and usually a tweed jacket. And then he always had an extra jacket and shirt in the studio if he needed to freshen up. You know, I'll tell you a little more about clothes. I liked to dress artistically, or what I thought was artistically at the time. So I came to him one day in a sweater and a hat with a flower on it, and he just opened the door and said, "Well, who are you today?" And then during recital week, he said, "Now you'll want to get your hair done." Which that did not offend me. I thought, "What are you talking about? You're from another generation." That's what I was thinking at the time. But anyway, then that for that recital, I wore a dress, and I think he approved. It was a plum-colored gown, part satin, part velvet, and he said, "Where did you get that dress?" Now, he had his sisters, he had nieces and nephews, but he was pretty private. He didn't talk a lot about them. He would share that on his trips, he liked to shop for their Christmas presents and birthdays by finding some fun jewelry or what scarves or what have you. He did have a grandniece that went into pop music, and he was really proud of her. Let's talk about him as a teacher. He talked a good bit in lessons. He would sit in his chair and talk with me about needing a concept. Even in class, when he would do piano literature, he would sit. And I need to sit to show you. And maybe y'all remember kind of how he was, but he would just sit. He might have books on his lap, and he would just look out. He would gesture with his hand, describe, using words very carefully, and then he would just look at you in your eyes and laugh. And I guess he would use laughter to bring levity to something great. When we started working in the studio, I was surprised he didn't address my technical problems. See, I had been accustomed to working an hour a day on technique, and instead, he talked with me about musical direction. Oh, dear. We'll come back to that. I'm sorry. He talked with me about musical direction, listening for the climax of the phrase, understanding the harmony, breaking apart each little bit. What was I saying musically? And the amazing thing was my technique started getting better. So he taught me the most valuable lesson, that it's all about the ears. The ears affect the body. I thought we would listen to another one of his performances. Maybe you all know this one. It's Homage to Edith Piaf, improvisation number 15 in C by Francis Poulenc. So let's take a minute and enjoy.
Thank you.
John was excellent with tone and color, and not only through touch, but through the timing of the sound. That impressed me right from the first lesson. I had never heard anything like that. So listening and musical direction, he would often mark in the score to hear, or even brace, to let me know, just kind of expand. And these type of directives were musical, they were physical, they were emotional, they were the whole package. I would like to share a couple of musical illustrations. This didn't come out as clear as I'd like, but this is a Wild und Lustig from David's Bühnlertanze, the second book by Schumann. That opening phrase, I'll just show you a little bit of a musical direction example. Let's see. Ah, you see the little red dot? All right, anyway, I'm up on the first system. So just kind of looking here, his markings show that this was the peak right in here. I'm going to play it under tempo, but I'll just show you. That type of thing. You know, as at that time in my maturity, I was thinking about just evenness and meter, he expanded my thinking. Let's look at another example. Let's skip this one. We're going to look at another example in a minute. Let's talk about the body. These tenets that I've put up here, they do run together. They do run together, as you know. It's kind of part and parcel. Let's talk about the body. So I said earlier, you know, that for me, he enlightened me that the ear really controls the body. But he did talk about the body and about how little things that you could do, little areas of focus would affect your sound. I've got some wonderful notes that he took. And, of course, you can't read that. It's too far away, but I will read. And this is from the inside of one of his scores, his score of Mendelssohn's Preludes and Fugues. So he writes, in general, lower wrist for Bach, fingers well inside key, balance hand from inside center of palm, small hand, fingers close, loose thumb. Leggero, feel keys pushing hand and fingers up, straight into keys. For light, fast octaves, open out elbow from inside. Feel keys pushing fingers up. Thumb arch high for octaves that need force. For legato, balance weight on fingertips with tips well inside key, little movement. To voice soprano, think outer muscles in upper arm. For deepest tone forte, think muscles in rear waist area. Now, I know when I started working with him, I started to think about how I sat on the bench, not only the height, but about really being planted on the bench like a tree, is what he said, feeling the roots going down. He would say things like, play from across the top of your back. Think the muscle on your outer arm, etc. I don't know if this was a Mannheimer thing.
Matthay.
That's a Matthay thing. All right. He wrote these notes in 1975. The Gospel According to Signy. What would we do without you? Okay, yeah, you can't see this, but from his score, like third system, he's written small hand. Yeah, and on the bottom system, this doesn't make good sense because you can't see it too well, but forearm. So he would make just these little notes. It wasn't like he was obsessed with, here, you're using this part of your body. No, just at times he would say, think from here. And it would change things. This is from his copy of Schubert's Fantasy in C. And you can't see all of his notes, but he's saying, weight from shoulder, weight of hand towards thumb, da, da, da. To avoid harshness, mold chord. And I like this, inflection, no matter what you play. That word inflection came up a lot. Rotation and grouping, of course. So he talked with me, he gave me the 9 steps. Let me bring up my, excuse me. Yeah, the 9 steps toward finger individualization, principles of piano forte playing. I give this to my students too. So less about the fingers, right? He would talk about rotation and he would use the example of a doorknob. Very, most importantly though, he taught me to follow the shape of the gesture and get my hand behind the notes that I was playing. He had a wonderful way of grouping notes together to change the way I would think about a passage. So this is his copy of the Mendelssohn Fugue in E minor. You can see the top system, how he's grouped. Yeah, these octaves. So, this is both grouping and musical direction. Let's see. So, that's one idea. That's another idea. Sorry, that was sloppy. But he'd get you to really hear the idea and have starts and stops like that. So another example of grouping. Again, you can't see it on the score, but up here he has little, like he makes his own slurs to cause the hand to follow the shape. This is also from David's Bühner Tanza. Letting these notes shape up to the melody. Of course, you don't play it like that, emphasizing it to that extreme, but letting the hand follow the shape. Yes, another one from Sirach. David's Bühner Tanza. Second system here. You can kind of see. Papa, 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 papa. You know, students are often so literal with their beats. And he would just kind of regroup so you could understand that musical idea. Of course, he taught me about arm weight. I love the exercises Signe reminded us of the other day. Talked about the finger. And David and I were talking a little bit about finger the other day, the places on the finger, the bony part, the cushiony part. And he gave me the illustration of mallets that would, you know, be used on a percussion instrument. A mallet can be made wrapped in yarn, or it can be that compact rubber. So think of your fingertips as mallets. There's different types of mallets. You can actually, he said, you can think emotion into your fingers. Now, of course, he talked about melody. We just talked about some sound and weight a little bit. This was the big thing, really. He would often, when he wasn't sitting in his chair, he would go over to the second piano, especially early on, and double my melody so I would hear it. And it would force me to play and, you know, come up to his sound level. Just learning to hear line and almost towing it like a rope and never letting it drop. Of course, he taught me about the point of decay and how to catch a note within the phrase, pick it up from that point of decay. Of course, he talked about energy off on the note. Once the sound has been made, he'd come and he'd wiggle the arm around to make sure you were only holding that note with enough finger weight to keep it depressed. But melody. Melody was the most important thing, right? Of course, melody can be found all over the place. And like I remember his saying in Beethoven, melody becomes harmony and harmony becomes melody. I also remember him talking about melody as a surfboard. And I really like that because you've got to stay on that surfboard. Always. And that actually has been a good tool for me with memory. You know, if I start to falter, keep singing, keep holding that. And that gives confidence, too. Maybe you know that Mr. Adams kept a blog for several years on Blogspot. Here, I'll read from one of his blogs. We must never forget the basics of musical expression and the long-established rules for unlocking musical thought. The most potent force in music is the power of melody. It can often be just a fragment, but even this can suggest much more than thought possible. Ask yourself how many times you have been moved by just an unexpected shift from major to minor, or the flight in the melodic line to a place you thought impossible. You know, it was said of John Adams' students, they did not sound like him. They sounded like themselves. I think that is a very nice compliment. I'd like to share with you a couple of short videos from some of his students. This is Charles Anchetta.
Professor John Kenneth Adams, he taught me a lot, but I think the most important thing he taught me was to take time to enjoy music. I think at one point he started to notice that I was working so hard to become a great classical pianist that I wasn't even really enjoying just making music. Before I was his student, I used to write music, and I was an all-state jazz piano player in high school. So I think it was halfway through my sophomore year at the University of South Carolina, he started to remind me of these things. He started to include different elements in my lessons, even if it was just for a minute or two. At any given moment, he would say, play something you wrote, or play some jazz. And he encouraged me to keep making music that I liked in addition to practicing music that was well outside my comfort zone. And I learned a lot from observing him. I remember one day I passed him while I was rushing to my next class, and he was outside, literally stopping to smell some roses. During my senior year, I was invited to his house for a get-together with some other students and colleagues from USC, and I witnessed how he appreciated everyone. At this gathering were amazing pianists from several different countries and, like I said, all the different professors that I admired. But that afternoon, we were just people hanging out, enjoying some food and playing everything from Christmas carols to show tunes. It was a fun time. So I was learning that while it's important to work hard, people have a lot to teach you and a lot to share, especially when you're outside of the practice room. As I got closer to graduating, he would take a few seconds here and there to give me little hints that making a living as a musician might not always be as easy as I was imagining it would be. When I was a student, it was a fun time for me because I was always being asked to do things. It wasn't really a struggle. I was lucky to be asked to play in a band or to be the musical director for a local musical. But when I would tell Mr. Adams about this, it was very humbling because he wouldn't say, "That's great," or "I'm so proud of you." He would say something like, "Well, I'm glad that you're finding work." One of the last times that Professor Adams and I spoke face to face, he told me to always try to find time to go to the piano and play. No matter what you decide to do in life, even if it's just for a few minutes, sit down at the piano and play. He didn't say practice or play all your scales, he just said play. So I am a musician, and I'm lucky that I have been able to make a living as a pianist, a church music director, a sometime arranger and music teacher. But even when I'm in the middle of grading papers or writing an arrangement for somebody, I hear Professor Adams's voice saying, "Get up and play." So I will. I'll just go to the piano and just noodle. It doesn't sound like anything, but it keeps me sane. You know how at the end of a doctor's appointment, the doctor will give you an order like, use less salt, drink plenty of water, or get more exercise? If Professor Adams was my doctor, his prescription for me to find peace during the craziest times of my life would be, go to the piano, sit down, and play.
Now let's listen to a recollection from Mion Sook Studenmeyer.
I'm Mion Sook Studenmeyer and live in Somerville, South Carolina, in the Charleston area. I teach at Charleston Southern University as well as privately in both Columbia and Somerville. Mr. Adams' influence is deeply engraved in me as a teacher and as a performer. For over 20 years, he was my teacher and mentor. My journey studying piano with him began in 1991, while I was pregnant with my daughter. At the time, I stayed home from Cincinnati due to my pregnancy. However, my desire to continue studying piano never diminished. I was willing to drive 98 miles from home to study with him. My husband took his piano literature class one summer and was very inspired by his knowledge. He then recommended that I request a lesson from Mr. Adams. With my husband's encouragement, I studied my first lesson with him and instantly loved his teaching style. Because of his substantial impact on my first lesson, I transferred my doctoral study from Cincinnati to the University of South Carolina. I knew instinctively after meeting him that this was the right decision for my family and me. Ever since then, he has been my mentor. The poster on the first screen was one of his piano portrait from the Charleston Southern University. Mr. Adams was no stranger at Charleston Southern University. He was a well-known pedagogue and performer through CSU guest recitals. Not only performing, but also educating music students and the community through his creation of piano portraits. One of his most brilliant projects was using PowerPoint and live music to introduce the significance composers' musical trend and their music. Debussy, Beethoven, Brahms, and Liszt were presented at the Charleston Southern University between 2011 and 2015, which were well received by the CSU community. He was not just a teacher, but a friend who deeply cared for the individual student. He cares for each student with the personal concerns and encouragement. I remember him saying, "I pray to God for all of my students every morning." Nobody could doubt the love that he had for his students. There were times where I was not in contact with him, but he understood the reasoning and would give me the advice, no matter what, never give up on your dream. His influence was endless through his refined performance and pedagogical method. His legacy will live through me and be passed down to my students. Thank you.
Now at this time, I was going to have our lovely Nancy Elton come to the platform and say a few words, but Nancy had to cancel her involvement this week. She fell ill, and she is better, by the way, everybody. So I have many, many, many personal stories about John, and I'm gonna just tell a few. I don't wanna keep you too long this morning. I will say, goodness, I have memories. One of my lessons was on September 11th, 2001, and I heard that news as I was getting ready in the morning, and it was a lesson day. I traveled in. He opened up the door. He said, "I can't believe this." I said, "I can't either." I proceeded to enter, and we talked for some time, and then just took such comfort in being able to play the piano. He continued to give me advice over the years. I had him come to Alabama as a judge to give piano portraits, to participate in the Foothills Piano Festival, to play at the Alabama Music Teachers Association State Conference, and I always treasured these times. And he was always giving me little advice. Like one time I set up a four-day festival with opening night performance myself, and he told me that maybe when running a festival, I don't want to also put on a full recital. And that night, over cheese and crackers, he said maybe a softer cheese would be easier to cut. And another time after an event, we went back to my home, and he said, "Do you have anything to drink?" And I did not. So he went up to his room. He came back down with a little flask. He said, "It's kind of nice to finish the day with some bourbon." So he asked me if I wanted to try it, and I did, and I agreed. That was nice. Something I remember, though, during my school days, I was working on Francis Poulenc's Promenades for Piano, which is a very dissonant work, and it took me a long time to just get those figurations in my hands, and I was forever in the reading phase. And I really was not bringing much for him to work with in the lessons. And he was getting frustrated. So one night, I just picked up the phone and called him. This was not something I would normally do. And I was crying, and I said he was just being too hard on me, and I was doing the best I could. And he just handled it like a father. He's like, "You'll be fine. Maybe I've been too hard on you. It's going to be okay." He let me know that he was proud of me in certain ways. I know in 2002 there was that figure skater, Michelle Kwan, who took the bronze. And he kind of suggested my accomplishments showed the same kind of perseverance. And I also remember I gifted him 1 year an orchid. And many years later, he called to tell me that orchid had gone out of dormancy and started to bloom. He was just a love. He really was. One other thing, I remember I went through a divorce, and I was in my apartment with my little four-year-old, and I confessed to him, I had to have a couple of glasses of wine at night just to unwind and get through the night, and then that made it kind of difficult to start practicing at 9 o'clock. And he said, "Well, you just want to take it easy there, and there'll be another time for that." And I even broached the subject of depression with him, and he said, "The sun has a way of coming through." Something that he said to me that I keep in my heart is, "Take courage." And he meant it musically. You know, you got to do what you need to do. And be brave in music. Be brave to live the artist's life. Take courage. So, I want to tell you about something very special that happened in 2018. It had been a few months since we had spoken. And a lawyer contacted me and asked for verification of my address, and I gave it to her. And then a few weeks later, I got an envelope in the mail. My husband, who's also a pianist, he and I had just come home from working with our Wednesday night church groups. And we sat at the island in our kitchen and opened up this envelope. And it said that he was willing me his grand piano, his Steinway concert grand. Well, we just, of course, sat up until the wee hours of the night talking and crying about this amazing gift, and it still has its intense impact on my life. And it came at a time, you know, for those of you that are in academia, you know, there are times when it can be tough, and maybe a season, a semester, where you have to make a stand for something that's not very popular. And it had been that kind of year for us in our department. So this was such a shot in the arm to me, just to keep playing, to remember what it's all about, and it was a real great inspiration. I have a little clip of me playing his piano in my home. Thank you. And that was Francis Poulenc's Nocturne number 8 in G. Did you know that John Adams loved film music? He made a recording of such tunes, his arrangements of All the Things You Are and As Time Goes By. And in his retirement years, he said he had a front row seat to Turner Classic Movies. He did an arrangement of a melody from a movie called The Constant Nymph, starring Joan Fontaine. The music was by Eric Korngold. And I have a little clip of his sharing an arrangement of one of those melodies from that film that he titled Tomorrow. This was on the occasion of his being named a Steinway artist and playing a program at Rice Music House in Columbia, South Carolina. Let's listen.
And there was one melody that, when I saw it, just struck me. I said, that's such a beautiful melody. So it was really for voice and piano, but I just arranged it as a piano solo. It's called Tomorrow, and I hope you enjoy it. always thrilling to hear a great melody.
It's always good to hear a great melody. So this concludes today's presentation. Thank you all.